4,000 years ago. Give or take a few hundred years. And 2,000 years after the British mainland separated from Europe, a people lived in this place now called Orkney. They were a hardy breed. And their houses and monuments are still there today. They knew the power of ideas. They knew they were not the first to have the power of ideas. They knew of an idea which had preceded all of their history. An idea from before history itself. An idea that preceded the manifestation of time and space. An idea that might have taken part in the creation of everything. Far-fetched? Around 350 BC. Or 2,700 years later. Plato believed, and many others agreed with him, that the universe was created out of nothing from the abstract entities we now call ideas. These ideas were eternal and everlasting, and existed before time and space existed. There are countless infinities of these so-called ideas. The most primitive idea that Plato believed had form was a fiery matter constructor, called now a regular tetrahedron. It is the first of the four platonic solids, relating to fire, air, earth, and water. This is a journey through time, accompanied by Plato's idea, from Neolithic Britain to the present time. I have dabbled in creating substance from ideas alone, with the help of the giants of thought, and its manifestation in various computer programs, like OpenScad and Erlang Wings 3D. I present this video to my friends, especially the sculptor of ideas at susancampbellimages.co.uk, in the hope that I can persuade them all that ideas are more powerful than things. The recent Olympic Games opening and closing ceremonies showed this. I think London won all the gold medals awarded for showing the world the power of idea. Vincit omnia veritas. Truth conquers all. And ama vincit omnia. Love conquers all. These are two that I mentioned that continue to be important ideas, encompassed by the Olympic movement. And I hope these ideas are refined in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, a country with the motto, Order me Progresso, or Order and Progress. I will now ask Professor Sir Jeagle McGeagle to tell us about Neolithic sites. The monuments at the heart of Neolithic Orkney, and at Scarabray proclaim the triumph of the human spirit in early ages and isolated places. They were approximately contemporary with the mastermass of the archaic period of Egypt. In the 1st and 2nd dynasties, the Greek temples of Samaria, and the first cities of the Harappa culture in India, earlier than the Golden Age of China. These sites stand as a visible symbol of the achievements of early peoples. You are now seeing the Ring of Brodgar. It is the finest known truly circular, late Neolithic stone ring, and an expression of the spirit which gave rise to Mieshow, Stenness, and Scarabray. The first survey of the Ring of Brodgar was in 1849 by Royal Navy Captain F.W.L. Thomas, who was drawing up Admiralty charts. He published in 1852 The Celtic Antiquities of Orkney, present-day excavations by Orkney College, at the nearby Ness of Brodgar site, between the ring and the stones of Stenness, have uncovered several buildings, both ritual and domestic. Pottery, bones, stone tools, and a polished stone mace head have been discovered. The most important find is the remains of a large stone wall, which may have been 100 meters, 330 feet long, and up to 6 meters, 20 feet wide. It stretched across the entire peninsula. The wall may have been a symbolic barrier between the Ring of Brodgar and the world around it. Invaders from Scandinavia reached Orkney by the 9th century, bringing a complex theology that they imposed on the pre-existing Orcadian people and monuments. The Ring of Brodgar and the Standing Stones of Stenness were then known as the Temple of the Sun and Moon. Young people supposedly made their vows and prayed to Woden at these temples and at the so-called Odin Stone that lay between the stone circles. Several of the stones at Brodgar contain runic carvings that were left by Nordic peoples. Archaeologists note that the diameter of the bank at Brodgar is almost exactly 175 megalithic yards, the same as the inner banks of the Avery in England and Newgrange in Ireland. The so-called megalithic yard at 0.8297 meters, 2.722 feet per megalithic yard, is a controversial measure originally proposed by Alexander Thom. Thom's thesis, which is based on a statistical analysis of Neolithic monuments in the United Kingdom, is that the building of these sites employed a common unit of measurement. This implied a transfer of information. Ewan Mackay suggested that the nearby village of Scarabray might be the home of a privileged theocratic class of wise men who engaged in astronomical and magical ceremonies at sites like Brodga and Stennis. A Neolithic, low road connects Scarabray with the chambered tomb of Michaud. Passing near Brodga and Stennis, low roads connect Neolithic ceremonial sites throughout Britain. That is enough of that tosh, Sir Jeagle. Let's move on to what these people did in later life. David Ockham will now give his stream of consciousness take on oscillations and periodic events in a vacuum. We used the power of ideas to revolutionize. The other thing that the Neolithic man needed, communications. I was reminded of the extremely rapid development of the building blocks of this on my visit to the Radio Museum in Kirkwall. Here this Neolithic man was returned to a child. A child of a change of the physical to the metaphysical. The physical represented the industrial chemical military horror of the early part of the 20th century. The ethereal and metaphysical is then the new domain of ideas. For the first time I see again my Michael Mouse gas mask that I wore as a two-year-old under the stairwell. When the sirens wailed and the bombs fell in Aberdeen, it was returned to the government in 1945 for possible reuse. I think the best reuse is showing it here as a reminder. The crystal sets, powered from the invisible energy around us. We prospected on the micro mountains of Galena crystals with a cat's whisker, looking for a good spot. We had each discovered a semiconductor junction diode. We loved the progress of the ones that did not stop working when someone moved your set, or even bumped it. They were encased in glass and made of a different crystal, germanium. I built a computer of these to play knots and crosses, or tic-tac-toe in America. But I became bored when I realized that it was just an enumeration of all the possible games, and I thought it had no future. We longed for valves, even one valve, but the batteries of the Clanchy cells that laboriously heated the electron-emitting cathodes soon ran out. The physical size of the valves, the inductance and capacitance of the associated circuits, which learned about when we twiddled with them on the crystal sets. This capacitance and inductance limited the maximum speed that the valve could operate. Wavelengths of 3 meters were considered short in 1939. 100 megacycles per second, or 1/10 of a gigahertz in today's computer parlance. It is appropriate to talk of computers because they are themselves, in essence, communications devices, both internally and externally. By 1942, by combining the capacitance and inductance of the surrounding resonating circuits into the immediate environment of the valve itself, wavelengths of 10 centimeters or 3 gigahertz were attained. This allowed the so-called centimetric radar. The real breakthrough was the discovery by Harry Brook and John Randall in Birmingham in 1940 of a cavity magnetron, shown here. It was said to be the most important cargo ever brought to the shores of the United States. It could produce 10 kilowatts of pulsed power at 10 centimeters wavelengths. Centimetric radar was born by the end of the war in 1945. These magnetrons could produce 2 megawatts of power at 8.7 millimeter wavelength. For the then top secret millimetric radars that are still used today in civilian and military radars, after the war magnetrons were used in microwave ovens, and it is estimated that 90% of American households own a microwave oven. They all descended from the 1189 model number 12 shown here. The transistor, which superseded valves in all but a few specialist applications, was a development of the technology of the lead sulfide galena diode of the crystal sets. We were all semiconductor pioneers then. The germanium diode was an important device for the important task of signal rectification. It could rectify, but it could not amplify. Enter the transistor. It was like two germanium point contact diodes joined together. My first was the Mallard OC71. It was a glass-encased point contact positive-negative-positive, PNP, germanium transistor. We scraped the paint on the case and made it a photoelectric effect detector. This was a PNP device. The complementary NPN devices were available in the US. but never appeared anywhere else, probably for security reasons. The US-based practical electronics magazines were always given great designs, including NPN. For push-pull amplifiers, but we could not get the parts. For the development of this essentially low-power device into today's silicon chips. The first silicon transistor needed the arcane skull of crystal growing to be developed. The skull was one of the pet areas of interest of my physics professor at Aberdeen University. The great man himself, Professor R.V. Jones. And in 1960, the first modern transistor was built. The computer then really took off.
They may have used this mechanical computer or advanced slide rule to calculate the times or do some difficult calculations. But I am going to use a fast desktop computer with 6 processors and 16 gigabytes of memory to show you the power of Plato and his idea of 4 triangles making up a primitive solid. Everything that you see in modern computer graphics is built from such primitives. I did not mean to make this video. I just thought that I would interest my friends in the use of the more up-to-date techniques that are being used today. I am not an expert. I did not know how to use the Wings program. It was the first time I used it. The meshes provided gave me a beautiful accurate model of a wartime Spitfire. I did not want to spoil it, so I tried to use the primitives provided. I chose a tetrahedron in the center. Then I chose a spiral cylinder around the center. Then I chose a mesh provided that looked like a ball. This immediately reminded me of graphics of the HIV/AIDS virus. I matched them visually. I now played with the sculpting magnets, both attracting and repelling, of variable strength. Michelangelo did not have the benefit of these powerful tools. That allowed me to distort the parts of the mesh as you can see. On reflection, I have decided to show you the Spitfire. It is rendered in pure silver and looks very much the beautiful machine it was in its pre-painted pure dure aluminium form. Just to illustrate the power of the Wings 3D program, I have made the model reflect as its environment a scene from the rings of Brodger. If you look closely as the model rotates, you can see one of the standing stones from this ring reflected in the surfaces of the Spitfire body and Wings. Wings 3D uses Plato's structures to model what you see. The wind edge data structure models used by Wings 3D explicitly describe the topology and geometry when three or more surfaces meet at a common edge. You can see Plato in the clear regular equilateral triangle centered on the micrograph of HIV virus. Does it go into the center in the form of an equilateral tetrahedron? Platonic shapes form the basis of myriads of organisms too small for us to be able to even imagine. One of the problems with early computer-aided design was, in my opinion, the difficulty of bridging the gap between the engineering designer's need for accuracy and precision and the sculptor's and artist's need for artistic expression. This has in recent years been addressed in the production of models for games and films. I am playing for the first time with an extremely powerful tool used in these fields. The amazing variable strength magnetic push and pull distorter. You can see me use the distorter in this short sequence. I have made no effort to show the true power of the magnetic sculptor. As, like any powerful tool, it can be used in many ways. From a palette knife to a bulldozer. I then enter the IDS-like ball and look for my tetrahedron. But it has become so small I cannot see it. Luckily I have near infinite powers of magnification. I find it and magnify it until it lives again. The process of manipulation of the facets of the graphical model is now the work directly or indirectly of millions of people who do not care about the nature of the ideas that make their work possible. And why should they, you ask? Well, it's like this. If you do not know what is, and by that I mean, what exists, or what is the expert's current way of doing things, then you will fall into a new dark age of ignorance, controlled by a few ruthless governments and corporations, intent on exploiting for themselves our joint knowledge. Why then, since before Neolithic times, the knowledge we all have, the power of ideas?
Okay, Sir Eagle, that is enough of that tosh. Now Jimmy Botham will talk about Neolithic chambered cairns in the Black Isle and Orkney.
By far the majority of the surviving chambered cairns In the Black Isle, lie near the summit of the Milbury, the rounded sandstone ridge, which forms the backbone of the peninsula. Situated approximately at its center point is Mount Eagle, 838 feet. And the ridge falls away gradually towards each end. The bulk of the cairns lie at heights of 400 feet to 600 feet above the sea. Excepting at Kilcoy, chambered cairns of the Claver group are not found in the same region as cairns of the Orkney Cromarty group. What is the reason for the exception here? No other horned or kidney-shaped cairn is known in the Black Isle, or for that matter nearer to it than the Hebrides, Caithness or Northern Sutherland. The bipartite chamber is the main feature of these cairns. The cairns of the Orkney Cromarty group are characterized by a more or less rectangular chamber divided into compartments by pairs of oppositely placed transverse slabs. The number of compartments range from one at a shade, and both, up to as many as 28 at the Knowe of Ramsey. In general, the round cairns of simple construction with two compartments occur on the Scottish mainland, and we may instance Stormall and the Channy in Sutherland, which are both enclosed like cairn glass in a round cairn. To these may well be added the ruined or incompletely exposed chambers at Contin Mains, Ballachnecor, Lower Lechanish, Balgagwy, Muir of Conan, Balmed, Midbree, and Woodhead, all in Easter Ross. The short-horned cairn of Garrywin in Caithness has a bipartite chamber, as does Kenny's cairn, although the latter possesses a lateral cell in addition. In Caithness, the predominating chamber form is tripartite. But even here, if we are to judge by the surviving roofed example at Camster, the outermost compartment was lintled and became in effect merely an extension of the passage. The corbelled roof covered the two innermost compartments only, giving the effect of a bipartite chamber. Sir John Randall's chamber was octopartite. If you find the Black Isle Brewery near Munloche, you can also find many chambered cairns in the Black Isle. Most of them are unsung, and only appear on the Ordnance Survey maps as chambered cairns. I have highlighted two near Balnakyle, where the backdrop for this part of the middle was shot. I hope you enjoyed our Neolithic ramble.